Alrighty, great. So I'm Amy Ivey. I'm with this. We said before the Eastern New York Commercial Horticulture Program. I'm just trying to get rid of this one screen here. Commercial Horticulture Program. And Brian Eschenauer and I put our heads together to cover this topic. And we did check in with Judd Reed as well, who gives a lot of good ideas for what all to include in this topic too. So you want to say hello, Brian, for the sake of the recording?
Yeah. So we're looking forward to talking about plant diseases in high tunnels, something we hope you don't see, but probably will, and give you a little background.
Exactly. Excellent. Give you an idea of what to look for. And you know, with this series, we don't have time to go into great depth on any, you know, any one particular topic. Mm-hmm. One of the things that we're not going to be able to do much today is control measures other than cultural control measures. But, you know, just as a, but we'll talk about how, what's going on. So, carrying on. So I'm going to kind of lead, and but Brian's going to join in. We're going to have this be a conversation between me and Brian, and feel free to put your questions in the chat box as we go. So the high tunnels can really do some amazing things. They protect the crop, especially from heavy rain or just even quantities of rain. And wind is a big factor. Having the plants not get banged around so much really helps them grow well. But it's the fact that the leaves stay dry that we really see a big impact on reduction in diseases. And so in particular with tomatoes, it's our favorites that we see out in the garden or in the field all the time, the early blight, subtropical leaf spot, and even late blight. In 2009, when we had the, you know, the total epidemic of late blight, it eventually got into the tunnels, but much, much later. And in some tunnels that I worked with, it barely got in. It just kind of came in from the sides. Because the leaves stay dry, it wasn't a conducive environment for it to take off at all. So there's some problems that, oopsie, that you hardly see at all in a tunnel, but then there are some problems that we either only see in a tunnel, like leaf mold, or that are enhanced in a tunnel, like powdery mildew, which loves a humid, powdery mildew does not like wet leaves, it likes the humidity, so if a tunnel isn't well drained, it's going to be a little more prone, can be more prone to powdery mildew.
Okay.
So management is so important. You know, I think when we work out in the field, we tend to be pretty much, okay, it's a pathogen. What am I going to do to kill that pathogen? In a tunnel, a lot of it has to do with management, prevention that will help to make conditions. You know, it's like the three legs of the disease triangle. If you can control the conducive environment, you can really help to suppress the diseases. And so management is so important. I always tell growers when I walk into a tunnel, my glasses should not fog up. And that's like a little barometer I use for them. But it can be very steamy, that the picture on the top right. You want to mention that, Brian? That's your picture?
Yeah. That was like walking into a cloud in that greenhouse. And so that can happen. The picture below it is the condensation there. And some condensation, you know, it's natural with the temperature differences, but when it starts dripping on the plants, that's when there's a real problem that disease can develop pretty quickly.
And they do make a plastic film that reduces the condensation or causes it to quickly roll right off, so it won't drip down on the plants. It kind of rolls down the side and doesn't build up like this. So if that is a challenge that people are having, that is an option that they might want to consider. But the gable, the ventilation is really the key. And this is I think we showed this last week as well. But so not only do you have the roll-up sides, and the higher the side, the better. So some growers will actually get extensions to make the sides even higher. So when they roll it up, they get all that nice ventilation on the side. And then big doors at the end, and then gable end vents. I really like seeing gable end vents at both ends of the tunnel to get rid of that air that builds up at the top as the hot air rises. This was an amazing situation. This is real life. So Brian knows the diseases. He's the pathologist. He gets the whole, you know, scientific side of it. I go out in the field, and this is the kind of thing that I see.
And I love this slide that you have here because it really tells a lot.
It's amazing how a picture can tell so many stories, right? Yeah, and this is a new grower. You know, granted, she's new. And she lives in a cold area, and she was so paranoid that it was going to get cold at night. She had winter squash, which is a weird thing anyway to put in a tunnel, but she had winter squash, and then all these tomatoes. She was closing her tunnel up completely every night. This was, I think, early August that I came. She was still closing it up every night out of fear that her plants were going to get too cold. So she had just, and we'll get to these diseases in a minute, but in here is raging leaf mold and powdery mildew. And can you see the leaves on this winter squash? I mean, they were basically white from the powdery mildew. But here are volunteer tomato seedlings. It must have been like a dumping spot she had or something. So they're not very good specimens, but those are tomatoes. And these are completely clean. And here they are, what, 20 feet away from absolute devastation and, like, you know, such rampant disease. And it just goes to show the difference in the conditions, that the spores can be present, but they won't take off unless the conditions are right. So that just kind of drives that point home.
And I see it too as a reminder, you know, don't have your call plants or a pile like that so close, because some diseases, like you mentioned earlier, in certain seasons, late blight might be able to get in that way if you have some of your crop plants so close to an entrance to the greenhouse or the high tunnel.
Yeah, so keeping that clean. Although, you know, again, if the conditions aren't right, it will help. Because you could carry it on your clothes and stuff too. So if you were brushing past that, you could be the vector yourself. But by keeping the conditions, they aren't conducive.
That is the point there, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so this is one of my favorite because we only see it in high tunnels in the east. Now, I think Judd has said, and maybe Brian as well, that you do see it in the field some, but only under conditions of high humidity.
It's rare.
Yeah, not like last summer when you had the drought conditions. You probably didn't see any in the field then. But it definitely is something that you sooner or later shows up in high tunnels, at least the ones that I work with. And it has many different names. It used to be called Fulvia fulva. Now it's called Cladosporium fulva. I call it leaf mold. Other people call it brown leaf mold, I think, to differentiate it from gray leaf mold, which we'll get to in a minute, or gray mold. But so leaf mold, brown leaf mold.
Amy, I hate to
go
add
an, please.
Add an, it's actually Passiflora fulva now.
Oh, you're right, Jed. You're right. I knew I was getting the wrong
name. Not that it matters at all, but
I think it first was Cladosporium, and then it was Fulvia, and then now it's Passiflora. Thank you. No, that's great. That's why we need to be in here together doing
this. The species name remains the same, so.
So yeah. If somebody will send it to me, either spell it so that I can put it in the notes, then we'll have that to make sure we've got the right one.
Yeah, hey, Jed, would you put it in the chat box?
I'll put it in the chat right now.
And I will amend the PowerPoint and when I send you the PDF. Thank you so much for that, Jed. No, please, anybody, jump in. You know, we're all together on this, and we're all learning from each other. And I do need to do it, let you know that everything I know about tunnels I've learned from Jed. So.
No, you don't have to say that, Amy. Thank you.
Yeah,
very nice.
We're a good team. Yep. But anyway, we're seeing more and more of this leaf mold. And even though ventilation will help to suppress it, once it gets in your tunnel, you're going to have it. I've seen very well ventilated tunnels. I even had a grower who moved her tunnel from one field to another field, but it must have either stayed on the structure, but probably more likely stayed on her clothing or something like that, and the spores got into the new location and just took off like crazy too.
So it's not soil borne, but it can stay in the structure.
Yeah, I don't know where. Anybody know where it persists? I don't know.
It overwinters in the soil. It's not, in a sense, a soil borne disease because it's not through soil splashing, but those spores will overwinter on debris in the soil.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Little bits of leaves that it might even look clean, but spores don't need much space.
That's true, yeah.
Thank you.
So, and I'll show you in a minute. So we do have a really nice fact sheet, if I do say so myself, about leaf mold that's in the box. So here are the early symptoms. And the first thing you'll see are these yellow polka dots. It's actually kind of pretty. It's very distinctive, very clear, defined yellow polka dots. And if you, to be sure what it is, just flip that leaf over. And of course, the conditions have to be right, but they're almost always right. You'll see the fuzzy sporulation on the underside. If you didn't see the sporulation, but you saw some kind of a brown pattern, patch there or darker patch like that, you could always stick it in a baggie for, you know, a few hours out of the light and let it, then the spores probably would develop on it. So it's pretty easy to diagnose. And it's was one of the most amazing things about it. It's really hard to spray for. I had a grower who the first year he had it, he kind of panicked and he used copper, which, you know, it's like the classic organic fungicide. But because it never rains in a tunnel, he kept putting copper on and he just turned his leaves blue. But he was only hitting the top side of the leaves. He had a very dense planting. And without getting the copper up physically touching where the spores are, it didn't do any good. So we had these blue plants that were, you know, completely. So it's really hard. But Chris Smart and Judd are doing a project right now looking at some spray options in tunnels. But it's challenging. So the very best thing to do short term, and it's so much easier really, is to use resistant varieties. And so this is a tunnel. Here, this is a Sun Gold completely plastered with leaf mold. And here's Rybelski right next to it, completely untouched. I mean, it really is remarkable how strong the disease resistance is with these varieties. You'll still get a crop, especially the first year. It does not get on the fruit. The fruit's affected because the plant is so affected. You can imagine how this poor old plant, how can it actually ripen up a heavy fruit load? But the fruit itself doesn't have the spots like a scab would be, like on an apple or something like that. And here's another planting, just again to show it, to drive the point home. These are two different varieties side by side. Look at this one is just covered with leaf mold. These leaves are right there, and there isn't a spot of leaf mold on them. So it really does just go to show you how strong that is. And on the fact sheet on the back page is a whole list of resistant varieties. And that list, you know, does change over the years as new varieties come out. But we do have that whole list for you on that fact sheet that's in the box folder for you. And this is a neat little video. I think it's kind of neat. A video I took. So this is this first row is Cherokee Purple. This one is pink Brandywine. It's all the same tunnel, all the same conditions, and then here's Rybelski. So, I mean, look at that. So if that doesn't convince you about resistance, I don't know what will. I do want to put in a little plug for video clips for all of you, because this is a really great tool for all of us in the field or anywhere in extension to be using whenever I've been able to take a short, and short is key, a 15-second maximum if you can do it, and then send that video to someone like any of us to help you out, to help you diagnose. The video really helps the person you're consulting with to get a better idea of what you're dealing with. Every time I send a video to Chris Smart, she always is so pleased. So it'll make everybody happy if you do that. So that's just a little tip. That's it. Let me move off of that. Okay. Any questions about the leaf mold at this point before we go on to the next one? I saw there are a couple of actions in the chat box. I don't know if it's anything we need to address now.
No, we're all set.
Okay, cool. So another one, and this is white mold is something that you'll see in the field. It gets on beans. It has quite a wide host range. But more and more, and I think we all have agreed on this, you know, Judd and Teresa and those of us who are doing more high tunnel involvement. Almost any tunnel I go into now, I'll find white mold, almost always, or at least one tunnel on a farm. So it's good to keep your eyes peeled for it. For some crazy reason, if it's on a tomato, some people call it timber rot. I don't get it. I like calling it white mold myself because it's white and fuzzy. It makes a lot more sense. I don't see any trees in here. But anyway, what you'll see, typically what you'll see is plants growing just fine. They look beautiful, no problem at all. And there'll be one plant that just looks awful. And when you go to look at it, and I have some more pictures coming up in just a second, you will find close to the bottom, and I'll show you in a second what it looks like, but you'll find a section of stem that is completely dry and brown like that. And so anything from that point up, of course, is dead because it can't, you know, nothing can pass that zone. And then the definitive diagnosis is you split it open and you'll see these, you can see the size of these, sclerotia, right?
Yes. Yeah.
And that's the overwintering structure. Those little babies will live for, 10 years anyway in the soil. Very long, persistent, and very, like little armored tanks that are hard to...
Right, they can survive. They've got a rind on them, basically, and it's pigmented, so it keeps them around for a while. And if a plant is put in nearby, they can germinate directly. Also, if the conditions are right, especially if they're outside, they could form a little mushroom-like structure, and spores could go out and then work their way into a high tunnel.
Good. Okay.
So when getting started.
Yeah. So when you are going to the single thing that I tell people to do is to remove that plant, because it'll be a whole tunnel and there might be two plants that have it. So there's no point in spraying anything. It's already too late anyway. So I encourage the growers to very carefully remove that plant and not to sprinkle the sclerotia along the aisle as they are pulling it out of the tunnel. Take a bag right in the tunnel, put it directly into that bag so that they're not losing any. Here's a picture that shows what it looks like. So here's just the kind of, I mean, it's just total death of the plant. And then see how this is kind of a jumbled picture, but here's the stem coming from the ground, all nice and green and healthy, and then wham, very clear line, and then just brown. And if you pinch it with your fingers, it feels hollow. It feels it's like leathery. The outer wall of the stem is very tough, and you can kind of compress it, and you can tell that it's hollow. And then that's when you split that open, that's when you'll find the black sclerotia.
And sometimes when you squeeze the stem, you can even feel that you're hitting something, and it would be those black sclerotia. And if you cut those in half, they'll be pure white in the center. So that could differentiate them from, say, mouse droppings or something.
Yeah, because they look actually they're even bigger, maybe a rat. Yeah, so that's a good tip to cut that in half too. But do be super careful to not drop those things around the tunnel.
And Paul Hetzler says sclerotinia seems much more widespread and possibly virulent as well than it used to be, even in field settings and a lot of crops. And he also put a link to a variety list there too. So we'll make sure that resource gets put in the box.
Resistant varieties?
I hadn't opened it yet, but it's from VegMD Online. So I expect that it is. And it looks like it's got TMV, leaf mold, variety list. That's from what I'm getting from
Other ones, because I didn't think there was a particular variety. Let me go back up. That was resistant to...
It may for, it's like for leaf mold, not for...
Okay,
stem.
Yeah.
But his comments about sclerotinia.
And I know I see the sclerotinia, the white mold on green beans occasionally in my own garden, maybe when the plants are too crowded, the year is right. So I agree with Paul. It's out there. And that it's that exact same pathogen that can go in and affect tomatoes.
Great. Anything, I guess we'll move on from there.
Yeah.
And this is another one that we see in tunnels more and more, again, because of the humidity factor, botrytis, and I'm sure anybody who does, this is one of those diseases that has a wide, wide host range. And what's your name? Brian is going to talk about it in just a second in terms of a mixed greenhouse. But in tomatoes, what I often will find is just the tip of the whole leaflet, and it's usually near the top. It probably was in a blossom first and then dropped and hit this leaf, but it's a little easier to notice the damage when it gets on a leaf. But this is like an early stage of it and pretty distinctive the way it's just the leaflet. And then this is something that you might see. It's called ghost spotting. And that is what botrytis does when it lands on a fruit that's, it can't really establish itself very well. It doesn't turn the fruit to brown much like it would a strawberry because the skin is so tough, I'm guessing. But when you see that ghost spotting, that is from the botrytis. And then this is one, actually Judd was with me this day. This was a grower who, we talked last week briefly about pruning tomatoes. And this is a guy who, it's easy to happen. You know, it gets away from you. And so then you come in and you're in a big rush and you just kind of run through and you just kind of rip off the suckers and rip off the leaves. And he was doing much too rough of a job. And so a combination of a larger kind of a not clean cut, open wound, you know, created the perfect environment, and then with some botrytis spores floating around.
Yeah.
We'll see this in the stem.
That's a good point, because botrytis is a weak pathogen. It requires the dead blossoms that Amy mentioned, or a wound, something that is naturally aging, and that's where it can get started. But once it gets going, if you have some of that tissue leaning against a healthy stem or another leaf piece, it can work its way into healthy tissue. But it always requires that wound or something that's on its way out to get started. It also needs moisture. So moisture in the greenhouse temperatures for about 10 hours, a tiny droplet. That's how the spores germinate, in that droplet of water. And so again, the humidity control is key for controlling botrytis.
Excellent. Anything about the ghost spotting that we should tell people? I mean, I would just, you know, remove those fruit that are damaged. Anything more that Judd or Brian want to add about the fruit itself?
Well, Judd might want to add something about quality. It doesn't sporulate really quickly, but I'm sure it dings it a little bit because of the look there, those spots.
Yeah, I agree with you, Brian. It doesn't really lead to a rapid breakdown. So maybe if this was like, say, a CSA farmer, that customer base would actually tolerate those ghost spots. In a wholesale setting, that's unfortunately unmarketable. But in perhaps an organic retail or a CSA situation, you could still use those fruit.
It's because it's superficial, right? It doesn't, yeah. On that, it doesn't get into the, okey-dokey.
Right, so
okay,
I work.
Brian, you take over this part.
Okay, I work in greenhouses mostly with ornamental crops, and I ran across this where the larger greenhouse, the employees were pulling plant parts that were affected by botrytis because they knew that sanitation was important. But if we move on here to the next image, and they were putting it all in this trash can. Unfortunately, that was there for about a week or so. They weren't emptying it each day. And so I pulled that out from the trash can. And I don't know if you can tell, but there's gray growing on that. So there's a lot of spores that are being produced, thousands of them. And just with a little air current, these are so small that they can migrate out of there and drift over and find the next tissue that might be susceptible. So, you know, putting a lid on that and moving it out is important. Whenever you move out plant material, you have the possibility of spreading it while you're taking it out. So it's important to keep that in mind.
That's excellent. So those are the big tomato diseases. We do have a couple other diseases we're going to get to, but while we're on the tomato topic, since that is, you know, kind of the primary crop, Brian and I did want to also address some of the abiotic problems. And these are ones that I'm sure you're all familiar with. Anybody who works with home gardeners has seen these. You also get them in the tunnel too. And cat facing, you know, that's directly related to cold temperatures while the blossoms are just getting pollinated and the fruit is just starting to set. Because they're in a high tunnel, a lot of people think, oh, well, this is warmer, this is more protected, I don't have to worry as much. But just be aware that it can get cold in a high tunnel on a cold night. And then blossom end rot, because of the trickle irrigation that we talked about last week, or depending on how people are irrigating, again, it's a classic sign that they're not getting irrigated enough. And I've had growers who say, I know that's working. I have, you know, I know I'm getting enough water. I had one guy who insisted, and he showed me on his pressure gauge on his pump. This was out in the field, but I know it, but turns out one of the drip lines was broken or, you know, shut off or something wasn't right. And that is why he had the blossom end rot. So if you see blossom end rot, go back and check on your watering system. It's pretty easy to correct once you get that straight.
And Jen asks whether it's enough water or regular watering.
It's not enough. So you can give a lot of water and then wait too long before you water again. When the plant doesn't have enough water, it can't move the calcium up from the roots all the way through the plant up to the fruit. So the blossom end is the farthest point. It's the farthest away you can get from the root in terms of the distance that nutrients have to go. And so calcium needs that water to move. And so if it didn't get enough water, then the damage occurs.
So it could be either, actually. It could be either the quantity of water or the regular. So if you're getting sort of up and down so that you're not getting a consistent movement to the end.
Yeah,
so ample and consistent is important, is what Jen said.
Yeah, oh, I gotcha. Yeah, and that happens a lot. People will say, I know I gave enough water. I water every day. So if they're watering every day and getting blossom end rot, they're not watering enough every day. So there goes your consistent thing. That's exactly right. Good point. And you hear that from homeowners all the time. And it's especially true for homeowners, you know, with containers. So a lot of people have tomatoes on pots on their porches and stuff. Now, these are two nutrient ones, and Judd was talking about them was it? No, the week before last, I guess it was, right? But often I get confused for diseases, and they look pretty scary. I can see why. We always see magnesium deficiency in tunnels, always, always, especially by midsummer on. It's on the lower leaves, though, so, you know, it should typically not worry people too much, but because it can be so striking, it can be kind of shocking. But this is just classic. It's between the veins. It's bright yellow, and again, it's on the lower leaves, and we really don't worry about it as long as the rest of the plant is doing well, and your foliar test that Judd was talking about will help you monitor that. So some magnesium on the lower leaves is to be expected. And then Judd was talking about manganese, and so I think you pretty much covered it. I know you covered it, but I just wanted to include that as a picture of something you might see, and this is really classic. And one of the things about manganese, too, is you tend to see that damage at about 5 feet, 4.5 to, it's pretty amazing how consistent. It's not lower leaves, it's kind of part way up on the plant. Not the newest growth and not the oldest growth. And so it's that zone of the plant and then that characteristic marginal burn that you see there, plus then the foliar test would then definitely pinpoint exactly what was going on. And as Judd said, we see it very closely associated with high pH. Anything we want to add on any of this stuff?
Looks good. Nice pictures.
Okay. And then this is a sad, sad story that happens. This is one of my growers. He grew this beautiful crop of tomatoes in his high tunnel. It looked gorgeous, beautiful, beautiful red. But every single one, when I went to an event that the chef had catered, the person who catered it used his tomatoes, and they were sliced. You know how you kind of lay them out like you spread them out like cards, you know, spread them all out. And every single edge had that bright white edge. It was just really too bad. Where'd my pointer go? Right here. So that's white wall. And then this is yellow shoulders. And then this is just all kinds of weird, uneven ripening stuff. And so there's quite a range of problems that can happen quite a lot of symptoms with uneven ripening, and they have different names. There's white core and all these different names like this. Often it's linked to a potassium deficiency or just some kind of extreme. Some of the newer growers, you know, just let things get too far. It gets too high. It's just tough conditions. But especially with potassium is what we're seeing. And when the tomato starts to set its fruit and really starts to size up, the fruit is a huge drain on potassium. And when we do these foliar tests every 2 weeks, you can just see the potassium levels just plummet at that stage that fruit is setting on the plants. And then also not only the potassium, but this affects the potassium, but tomatoes really want to be at a pH of 6.5. I heard Steve Bogash from Penn State talking. He said, did I just say 6.7? No, I said 6.5. Tomatoes want 6.5. I mean, he must have said that 10 times. So trying to keep that pH down there can really benefit tomatoes in particular. I think I've got one more picture, and this is the kind of thing Brian and I were talking about this. Judd actually taught me this tip. Big beef is one of the more popular indeterminate varieties, especially for the organic growers. It's considered an heirloom. I don't know if it really is or not, but they consider it an heirloom, so a lot of people grow it. It's a beautiful tomato, but it just likes to be on a double leader. And so if you train big beef to a single leader, you are more apt to see yellow shoulders. It's just like a little quirk or a little tip kind of thing. It's not a definitive, you know, you always will have this problem, but just a little tip to keep in mind for pruning. Anything you want to add on that one, Judd or Brian?
No, if you grow big beef, you will have yellow shoulders in a high tunnel. That's my experience.
Oh, all the time, even if it's a double leader, huh?
Is it a double leader or is it an attempted double leader?
Ah, that could be too. Yeah, you're right.
I have seen it grown on a more of a hedge system on a stake system successfully without yellow shoulders inside. So I don't know if you can get away with it with 2 liters. But okay. If you grow it with a Florida weave, I think you can do okay.
Okay. Is it all the fruit or enough to make you not use that cultivar, or is it just spotty?
My experience is it's most of the fruit. It's
wow.
Maybe not all of it, but a majority. Enough to make it an undesirable. And as Amy pointed out, there's so many other great varieties out there and that are resistant to leaf mold that you'd be better off growing one of those anyway.
People just love it. They just, some people start with big beef. And it is like the canary in the coal mine too, because that's what I find happens. They tend to be organic growers. They grow big beef. And then all the heirlooms as well, you know, like the Brandywine and the purple, Prudence Purple and all that. But those are the ones where the leaf mold will really hit. And then you'll know when you have leaf mold. Something else we see that's abiotic is this blossom blast. And so many people think that hot temperatures are good, that tomatoes like it hot. Tomatoes like it warm. And I often think of it as they like what we like. And I don't like it when it's over 90 degrees, and neither do tomatoes. So you really don't want to ever let your tunnels get over 95. There are a lot of tunnels that if you don't ventilate well, they'll get over 100, you know, they'll get up to 105 and such without good ventilation. And so one of the effects of that is you can get the blossom blast. It's not the only reason why blossoms might, and blast just means they die. I think I've got one more picture. No, I don't. Sorry. But blast just means they die. It doesn't necessarily explain why they died. But a common thing that I see a lot is this high temperature. So. And then leaf rolling, and I think I mentioned this last week, but if you prune too much all at once, a typical response is leaf rolling. And I've had a lot of growers, again, they're rushed, they let things get away from them, they came and they did this big blitz of a pruning, and the next day they go to the tunnel and they see this, and then you get the call, and they think this, it looks like a virus to some people, and they think they did something that maybe through the pruning they spread a virus, or they have a real panic. So this you win a lot of brownie points if you can see this and see that it is leaf, and you know that they just pruned heavily the day before. It really can put their minds at ease. You can see this wasn't a very good job. This place is kind of a mess anyway. So this is often you see this when the growers aren't just staying, like we talked last week, stay on top of it, and it's so much easier. You let things get out of hand, and then you try to clean up in one big blitz, and it just isn't a good way to manage things. But it's kind of, unfortunately, it's the way a lot of people approach it. So, Brian, I think I'm going to, now we're getting into the mildews, I think I'm going to let you start doing more of the talking.
All right. So, back to a disease here, powdery mildew. Amy has the words up there. It actually is less of a problem in the summer. Most of the powdery mildew species that we see in on tomatoes have a temperature range from 60 to 70. That is their optimum. When it starts to get into the mid to upper 70s, powdery mildew actually slows down. So it is a problem in the cooler greenhouses, and light also affects powdery mildew. And that's one of the reasons we don't see it outside in the garden very often.
So the light inhibits it, you're saying, right? Mm-hmm.
That's right. Yep. The UV rays. We'll take a look later at a close-up of the spores of powdery mildew. And they don't have any pigment on the outside. They're pretty fragile, and UV rays will actually zap them.
So in a tunnel with the way we train things, there is plenty of canopy cover down below. So when I've seen it take off in a tunnel, it really takes off in that lower part, just like you're saying. It doesn't get up to
right. And part of that is because of the lack of good air movement down in that canopy. And so ventilation is a key for controlling powdery mildew, getting good air movement.
Great. Ready for the next one?
Yep.
Oopsie, I went too far.
Yes. All right. So we're going to take a look at this video here. And what we're looking at is a leaf surface here. And that is a spore that we're pointing at there. And you can think of it, it looks like an egg, but you can think of it, you know, as a seed of the fungus. You know about spores. And we're going to watch this one germinate and see what happens with powdery mildew.
Can you hear the sound?
We don't need to. I'll do the voiceover.
Okay, let me get that.
So here it is. It's forming this structure. It's called an apisorium, but it's just getting ready to penetrate. Some of the powdery mildews will go through stomates on tomatoes. That'll either go through the stomates or through the tissue, and it's penetrating down in, it's releasing some enzymes. So if this is a powdery mildew species that can get on tomato, it will successfully be able to penetrate down in through the wall, but it's keeping the membrane intact, so the cell is alive. And this is a contrast to something like leaf mold or botrytis, where they kill the cells and then slurp up the digestive juices. This one keeps the cell alive, forms those root-like structures, and takes the nutrients from the living cells and puts it into the fungus body. And that's what we're going to see in this next, the last clip we have here.
All right, I got to make it come up.
And so it's using that energy that the cell is producing, it's hijacking it, and it's putting it into the fungus. And it's sprouting. It's also putting down other root-like structures in other cells, extracting energy. And then when there's enough of this, and this is when we can start to see the symptoms, that white film on the surface of the leaf, it will produce these spores. And, you know, this is an animation. With a hand lens, you could see these spores. If it's an older lesion, the spores might already be gone, but a new one, especially at the edge, you can see those spores. And it doesn't take much to dislodge those spores. Just a little draft will do it. And this is an animation here, and this is actually a powdery mildew on wheat, but it works the same way in tomatoes in a hive tunnel. And you can actually see clumps of the spores when it's bad enough if you're moving the foliage. And so you can imagine just how that could spread. All right.
Yeah.
Move on to the next slide.
Yeah.
So powdery mildew, we don't see it in the garden very often or in the field with field-grown tomatoes. It does like being inside where water isn't on the foliage when it's not exposed to rain. The foliage is relatively dry. We need the humidity, but there's not water on the surface. And that's one of the reasons that it grows well inside. With water on the surface, you have a lot of bacteria that can actually compete against the powdery mildew. And so it's not landing on an empty surface. Consistent humidity and lower air movement are factors that also will increase the powdery mildew, in addition to what we already mentioned, the light and the temperature. And it's important to be aware, there are three species of powdery mildew worldwide that can get on tomatoes. There's two that can occur in New York. And the host ranges are somewhat complicated for these fungi, because in lab settings, they can go to things we might not expect. For example, rosemary and outdoor potatoes and eggplants can actually host some of the powdery mildew species that could go over to the tomatoes. So be aware of that, especially be aware if you've kept any tomatoes around from a previous year, that there might be some powdery mildew there that you're not realizing. It might not be a very severe infection, but those spores could move from those overwintered plants to the new seedlings and could be spread from there. So I think it's happened. You can ask Judd sometime about those stories. But powdery mildew, because it lives on living cells, it does need a host to bring it through the winter. And it could be one that you're keeping around.
Well, can you also mention, before we go off of powdery mildew, about, because like, so many people grow cucumbers in tunnels and they get powdery mildew as well. So, but that's a different.
That is going to be a different powdery mildew than what you're going to see on tomato. There's a lot of specialty. What you see on lilac is a different powdery mildew than the powdery mildew on tomatoes. And even within the species, so you could have the same genus and species, there are some strains that like certain host crops better.
Great.
All right, so we'll contrast powdery mildew with downy mildew. And this is the first thing you see with downy mildew. These lesions, kind of like leaf mold, there's some yellowing on the top. And then if we look at the next image, you're going to be able to see this is how it gets its name, because it's this fluffy material, this fluffy fungal fruiting structures, actually, that are downy, like down feathers, that is how it got its name. But you can also remember it because it's down on the underside. Most all the time, the sporulation is going to be on the underside. So you flip that leaf over and you can see that sometimes it's not always there. It really does need humidity for that those fungal structures to appear. And I've got another image or two here.
Oopsie, sorry, what did I just do?
Well, we got a close-up view of that. Oh. If you look at that with a hand lens, you could start to see even some of the spores. The spores are formed on the underside of the leaves, kind of like upside-down trees that are holding those spores. Spores have a little bit of color to them, but what's holding them up is colorless.
I'm going to pause just 1 second. I think I hit something funny and I've lost the...
I think that was a link, actually. So it looks like you're...
Oh, that's what happened.
I had...
Yeah, I know. That's like, I know. I'm trying to figure out where did I go. I'm trying to figure out where I went. I'm not seeing my exit full screen thing.
Oh. Maybe if you minimize the browser.
Thank you, Brian. Very good. Yep.
Okay, and so this is a closer up view, upside down. What you might see with the hand lens. Not a great image there, but you kind of get the idea. And one last image on this slide. And that's what we would see under a compound microscope. So the spores are there, the spherical structures, and then the spore that's holding them up.
Yep, I often hear people talk about looking like little trees.
Yeah.
Good description. Yeah. And this is something if you see something and you're suspicious of and you do see something dark on the other underside, this is a classic one to put into a baggie and let it sit for a day. It's closely related to late blights, and that's what we do with the late blight tomato samples.
Yeah, so late blight is on tomatoes. This Downy mildew we don't see on tomatoes, but it's related.
Right, but I just mean in terms of to get that sporulation that's so characteristic, a baggie will really help you. High tech.
Baggie and a wet paper towel.
Yeah.
Ellen, I like these, Amy, these are your images, mm-hmm. if you want to talk through.
Yes, and I was shocked. I didn't really realize anything was going on here, and Chris Smart paid a visit up. This is at the Willsboro Farm High Tunnel, and I had seen the yellow, but I really didn't think much about it. I thought, I was focusing on other things, I guess, and I saw yellow, but I thought, and boy, she went right to that, flipped that leaf over, and look at how dark, and this was in peak sporulation, so it was, I had no idea it was that extensive. I was just shocked. And then this is a little bit later on. I tried cutting it back to see if I could salvage anything, and it just gets worse and worse. They often talk about downy mildew because it is, late blight. Sometimes I'll call downy mildew the late blight of whatever it is. And boy, it spread as fast as late blight spreads through this patch of basil I was trying to grow.
And just like
downy mildew only on basil?
Yes.
These are real specific. Downy mildews tend to be pretty crop specific.
This is one that is exclusive to basil.
And we're seeing more and more of it sooner. Any of you who work with home gardeners as well, a lot of the home gardeners can get it on the plants that they might pick up as six packs, or it might blow in.
Especially, I like that analogy because it is a late season problem most of the time now. And we used to not have it, but now pretty much every year the conditions will be right. So late in the season, it will get started. And in a short period of time in the garden, it can defoliate the plants. So make pesto while you can.
Yeah.
All right. And so some downy mildew, some nice images. I believe you took these, Amy.
I think Laura McDermott did.
Myself, I've seen downy mildew. Sometimes it looks really white on the underside. But it's out there occasionally.
Yeah, and this is brand. This is new. We've only had it confirmed in the Hudson Valley, and then one grower in Washington County. So Meg McGrath out in Long Island is very interested in knowing about this. So if any of you out around the state, and it tends to be in the wintertime because it likes the cooler temperatures. If any of you see something that you're suspicious of, please get one of us or send us samples or do something. And Meg will send it actually down to a colleague. I forget where the colleague is who is looking at what strain or what race it is, because we're really trying to get a handle on what's going on with this downy mildew and spinach in particular. Are you seeing it in the West at all, Joe, that you know of? Have you had any occurrences?
Excuse me. Yeah, it seems like that is becoming every year disease, unfortunately. Okay. Yeah, unfortunately. You never, it's like a lot of downy mildews, you don't know when it's going to hit, but I agree with Brian. Make your pesto early.
Yeah, this is spinach we're talking about here, though.
But sorry.
That's no problem. But because I think the spinach isn't nearly as obviously, that's why I was surprised. Yeah, because I think the spinach isn't quite as widespread. The basil is pretty much every year we're going to see it. But
yeah.
Have you had any spinach, Downy Mildew, out your way, Jed? Oh, you're muted.
No, we don't see a lot of it in Western New York because most people get their spinach from the supermarket, not a hydro.
Yeah, you don't have nearly. Yeah, the East, it's really interesting, the regions around the state, how what people choose to grow. Yeah, so this is new. This is new for us. It was just this winter in Eastern New York. So it's, yeah. Anyway, so keep your eyes peeled for us. We'd appreciate it.
Yeah, I think the point people should remember on spinach downy mildew is that this, with all the high tunnel growing we have going on now, this can become a year-round disease, right? Because there will always be a live spinach plant in New York State, at least as long as people are growing in high tunnels. You'll have spring crops, fall crops, summer crops. So unfortunately, this one has the potential to stick around year-round now.
Yeah. So we're just trying to get a sense of where it shows.
And I think, you know, since it's grown so close to the ground, it's really hard to get good air circulation through there. And especially, I think, when it gets a little bit cool, you got the condensation maybe occurring on the leaves. It's really a nice setup for this disease.
Yeah, and unlike tomatoes that we water with drip, it's really hard to water crops like spinach when they're grown like this, so dense, with any kind of drip. So it tends to be overhead watering, which then gives you that wet leaf in a cool situation, which is what the downies really love. And then lettuce downy mildew is a whole nother one. So far, we haven't seen it to any degree anyway, but that's another one that we're watching, because as more, especially out my way, as more and more people are going to winter greens, these problems are starting to crop up, and we're trying to, at least to begin with, at least assess how widespread they are. So keep your eyes peeled. But that's a totally different organism from the spinach, and it's different from the basil. Oh, it's challenging. And I just threw this in because basically, because this is a short course and we can't teach you everything, that winter greens are tough. And there are all kinds of things that happen with them. And sometimes we can figure it out. Sometimes we can't. Sometimes it's related to conditions. You know, it got too cold. There's off-gassing from the little bit of heat people might be using. This might be cladosporium, which is a common, it's not a real serious disease, but it messes up what you're trying to sell. You know, who knew what happened to this charge? So just it's like a humbling, this is the slide of humility to say that we don't have all the answers. It's challenging. And don't jump to conclusions as to what's going on. We're stymied too, so we'll all work together and help each other out.
All right. And, you know, maybe you can just click through to have all these points here. This will be on the presentation. It's a lot of what we covered. We are running out of time. Amy, if there's anything that you want to really pull out of here to make sure that we hit, you can do that. Otherwise, we can take any questions as we are wrapping up here.
Yeah, and I see I stuck that resistant varieties in that day because that's my big one is looking for resistance. So I stuck it in as Brian and I were talking this morning and I didn't do my spell check and I didn't space it out right. So I'll correct that on the final one too.
Yeah, that's key. Your images showed how important the resistant varieties are.
Yeah.
That's good.
So that's our last slide, I think, right? Yep. And so any questions from the group? And I have no idea what time it is. I don't even have a clock that I can
look at. It's 12:53, but anyway, people can certainly either unmute themselves for questions or type them in the chat. And we can go over. It's just, I know we start losing people, so.
Yeah.
Yep.
Jen says spinach pesto is good too. That's true.
It's Jen again.
It's funny that you make lemonade.
Very good.
Jen's trying to say something.
Oh, no, that's okay. Yes, in fact, there's a grower who I'm trying to entice to come up for our, is it April date that we were looking at? Or And one of the things he's doing for their restaurant is that he's got, well, he had stuff in his high tunnel just a little while ago, and it was mixed. It was spinach and kale and a couple of other things that they were harvesting. And in the high tunnel, they were also using row covers over, I think you showed a picture of that too, but I'm thinking, isn't that like an ultra perfect place for the downy mildew to get going on spinach?
Yeah, it creates that environment that we were talking about. You know, it's that classic situation.
Right. So now if I tell him about that, then he's sure to have it then. You know, so it's, once you know about it, it seems to come visit. So.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. That's what you mean. Yeah, exactly.
And Amy noted, but I was also going to say April 26th to 27th, make sure it's on your calendars pretty soon. We're just finishing up the agenda, and I'm going to be sending out a request to find out who's coming. We do have funds for hotels and food and things like that, use like that. So, but yeah, we'd like to have as many people. If we fill up the room and we have more people in the room, that's a good problem to have. So,
And I took this picture at a tour that Judd arranged a couple of years ago at a high tunnel. And I know he's working on places to see like that for this time.
Yeah, we're going to work in two tours, right? I think we've decided on that, which is
actually three if you count the one at the experiment station.
Right. So it's going to be great, you guys. And there's nothing like getting out and seeing these different, and each of the places we're visiting is quite different from the other. So you'll get a nice range of experiences by coming to that. So please do come. Jen, you were trying to say something.
The fun part is going to be working with IPM plans.
What was that?
But the fun part is working through the IPM.
Oh, yes, and those wonderful IPM plans that we're going to be doing. Yes, how could I forget that part? What's wrong with me? But Jen's been trying to say something. Jen, the floor is yours.
No, I wanted to know, just detail-wise, how many growers can we, could we, you want growers there, right? And how many?
Growers. I mean, if you come with 25 growers, that's probably too many. And I'm assuming that some people will have trouble bringing a grower, so, you know, we can share your growers amongst everyone to work with, because they're our kind of resources for information. But yeah, if you can get a couple, that's great. I mean, how many do you think you might have?
Oh, two. You know what I mean? Wasn't sure if it was a one-to-one or if maybe
we'll take more
three.
Because I have a feeling that some people will not be able to come with a grower. But again, if we have more growers, that doesn't hurt us either.
Okay. All right.
That'd be great to have some growers there. Mm-hmm. That would be wonderful. So if you can recruit some people, that'd be good. Great. Anything else, anybody?
Amy, I have a question. It sounds like for disease control in high tunnels, number one, resistant varieties, and number two, circulate the air through the place.
Yeah.
Anything else, or is that basically the main two things?
I might ask Judd to weigh in here. I don't see people using fungicides much, and in tunnels. I see them using insecticides, but fungicides I'm not seeing quite so much. So it really does come down to the pruning, you know, that all goes in with the air circulation and stuff. Judd, are you still with us?
Yep, I'm here. I agree with you, Amy. I think it's in many ways we're using a high tunnel to reduce diseases that require leaf wetness or soil splashing or something like that. We didn't get into some soil-borne diseases. That's kind of a whole other discussion. But
grafting, I was thinking.
Grafting. Yeah, but I think you're onto it, Russ. The idea is to keep that environment as dry as possible and rely on resistant varieties. And so the challenge for us as educators oftentimes is to particularly have our organic audiences consider some of those resistant varieties because they may be more inclined to use heirlooms or open pollinated varieties that don't have the resistance that come with growing inside occasionally. But they are the group that can probably most benefit from using the tomato varieties that Amy mentioned. But I think you've got it. We want to be have good ventilation and be dry in there.
Yeah, and things like, you know, the verticillium and fusarium, at least then again with the resistant varieties, you can do that. We didn't mention grafting. Judd especially has been looking at grafting, which will help some of the, you can take an heirloom and graft it onto a vigorous rootstock that could tolerate some of the soil issues. But if you have leaf mold coming in, you know, it's not going to help. So it's more for the root vigor if that becomes an issue.
So we can get some resources on that. I think Judd has some on grafting and even how to do it yourself. And then also If there are soil-borne diseases that we didn't get covered, we can certainly put resources in the box.
Yep. And just a quick mention on grafting. I do know some newer growers who hear about grafting and they start out their first year or two with grafted plants. And I've learned this from Judd, but I really don't think they need to worry their first couple of years with to go to the expense of grafting. Go ahead and grow in that soil. It's usually pretty new soil. So you shouldn't have any soil-borne problems as long as you have good drainage early on. So it's really more as you start to develop issues with your tunnel soil that the grafting really can pay off. In general, would you say that, Judd? And you always get more yield with grafting, but maybe you would see more benefit if you waited.
No, I think you're right, Amy. One thing to bear in mind is that grafting is an additional cost to the grower. So you need to justify that cost. And if there's no yield benefit because your soil is in good shape, it becomes an economic negative. What else can we say? The other thing is that you're increasing the vigor of that plant. So that means the plant's going to have a higher nutritional demand. So is the grower in a position where they are going to be able to deliver those increased nutritional demands of a grafted plant? And then finally, the other issue to consider is increased foliar diseases, because you're conferring so much additional vigor to the plant that you're getting into a tighter canopy. And we go back to the diseases that Brian and Amy shared with us that thrive in a dense canopy, such as botrytis, leaf mold, powdery mildew.
Yeah.
White mold.
White mold. Yep. Oh. Absolutely. So it's not a silver bullet. That's the main thing.
Well, it's 101 and we're starting to lose people. Thank you very much. We can also do questions later. If anyone has any questions, they can send them directly to the speakers or send them to me and we'll get them out. Put them on the listserv is actually nice, because if one person has it, then probably other people do too. That's great. Thank you very much. I want to see Catherine Martinez.